Hey, good evening, everyone. Welcome to our speech showcase. We're really excited to have our students perform for you tonight, and we're going to be going for a solid 2 hours. So if at any point in time you guys need to get up, use the restroom, or leave, feel free to do so in between performances. But we're really excited to get kicked off tonight with a choral reading. And I don't know, maybe it's because I'm an 80s kid, but it's called We Are the Breakfast Club. So I'm excited about that. To showcase that. Before these guys get going, they're going to go ahead and get into their spots. I do want to introduce our coaching staff here. I have to my right Maggie Jackson. All right, she used to be a judge, performed here at AP, and now joined us on the coaching staff this year. And as always, Bobby Abbas, who should be head coach, but she does an amazing job with these kids. And helping us out this year with musical theater was Katie Furland, and you'll get to see that performance coming up. So how about a round of applause for this group that's getting us started? We are the Breakfast Club.
That led them to a Saturday detention, he assigns them an essay to describe who they think they are.
These five high school students, all in different stereotypes, will be led to pour out their hearts and discover they have a lot more in common than they thought.
You may not talk. You will not move from these seats. You will not sleep. You will write an essay no less than 1,000 words describing to me who you think you are. Maybe you'll learn a little something about yourself. My office is right across the hall. Any monkey business is ill-advised. Any questions?
Does Barry Manilow know you raid his wardrobe?
I'll give you the answer next Saturday. Don't mess with the bull, you'll get the horns.
As Principal Vernon leaves, we start to see our characters exemplify what their first impressions hold true.
Hey, Sporto, what'd you do to get in here? Forget to wash
your... Excuse me, but I think we should just write our papers.
Just because you live in here does not give you the right to be such a pain, so knock it off.
It's a free country.
Just ignore him. He's just doing this to get a rise out of you.
You couldn't ignore me if you tried.
You know, there's not supposed to be any monkey business.
Have you finished your paper?
No.
What are you going to do?
Drop dead, I hope.
You better go find out.
From our first scene, Claire, the princess, Miss Popular, future prom queen, is immediately okay with talking to Andrew, the jock wrestler.
John, the rebel, the criminal, Mr. No Good, immediately antagonizes each of the fellow students.
Allison has not yet spoken, as she is considered the biggest outcast in the group, her defining trait being a basket case.
Just what is a basket case?
A person regarded as useless or unable to cope. In other words, defenseless, impotent, powerless, vulnerable, weak.
Finally, that leads us to our last stereotype, our nerd Brian. A perfectionist who is kind to each of the other students and struggles to feel accepted by them.
These five characters are the stars in our show and make up The Breakfast Club. The name comes from director and writer John Hughes' personal life. He originally titled it Detention, but he overheard a friend's teenage son call Saturday morning detention The Breakfast Club. The name stuck. The Breakfast Club was released in 1985, nearly 40 years ago.
The film was an instant classic because it is still relatable today in so many ways.
The cliques, the stereotypes, the stresses of high school, and the struggle of fitting in.
As the characters connect, they realize their social statuses may differ. The reasons they each got detention are unrelated, however.
They are all in a constant struggle to be understood by not only the adults, but by each other. The pressure to fit in.
The expectations to perform up to their authority-figure standards.
Their problems are the same. Throughout the film, they realize they're all more similar than they ever thought.
Under pressure. Pressure pushing down on me, pressing down on you, under pressure.
After an escapade to John's locker and a bonding moment, the teenagers really talk.
Letting their guards down and setting their differences aside creates a whole new group dynamic. Family.
My home life is unsatisfying.
You want to run away because your home life is unsatisfying?
Well, everyone's home life is unsatisfying. Otherwise, people live forever with their parents.
Go away.
Where do you want me to go?
Go away. You have your problems.
I do?
You do everything everybody ever tells you to do. That's a problem.
Okay, fine. So what's wrong? Your parents?
Yeah, they ignore me.
What about your family?
Oh, mine? Calls me stupid, worthless, no good, freeloading, big mouth, know-it-all jerk, and I forgot disrespectful.
Is that for real?
It's all a part of your image. I don't believe a word of it.
You don't believe me?
No.
Do you believe this? It's about the size of a cigar. This is what you get in my family when you spill paint in the garage.
In my family, if I do what my mother tells me not to do, it's because my father says it's okay. There's like this whole big monster deal. It's like any minute divorce. They're both so strict. It's like they use me to get back at each other.
Ha!
My father, I hate him. He's like this mindless machine that I can't relate to anymore. All he cares about is, you've got to be number one. I won't tolerate any losers in this family. Win, win.
I think your old man and mine should get together and go bowling.
With first impressions gone and walls broken down, our struggling teens empathize with one another.
This will further be shown in their acknowledgement of just how they each came to be in detention this Saturday morning.
I tortured a poor kid because I wanted my father to think that I was cool. He was weak and skinny. I thought about my father and his attitude about weakness. I jumped the kid and started wheeling him. How do you apologize for something like that?
Detention.
I ditched class to go shopping. I'm not defective. I should have been able to get one of my parents to talk me out of it, but they wouldn't this time.
Detention.
I pulled a fire alarm. I fought with the teachers and other students. I don't care that I'll be in detention 8 more weeks. It beats being at home.
Detention.
I was under so much pressure from my parents to succeed, to get good grades, to be perfect. When I failed my shop class, I thought up a really bad plan. I brought a flare gun to school and it went off in my locker.
Detention.
You know what I did? Nothing. I didn't have anything better to do.
Through each conversation, the high schoolers understand each other on a deeper level.
Creating friendships they're not entirely sure will last outside of this detention Saturday when they return to school Monday.
Back with their friends, once again in their cliques, the answer never fully revealed to a wondering audience.
John Hughes' thought-provoking movie is why it is considered a quintessential 1980s film.
In fact, The Breakfast Club is ranked as one of the top 500 greatest movies of all time.
Entertainment Weekly went so far as to rank it the number one film on their 50 best high school movies.
All 5 Breakfast Club members were nominated and won the Silver Bucket of Excellence Award for their performances.
The music was also notable. Upon release, the soundtrack album peaked at number 17 on the U.S. Billboard chart.
The iconic song, Don't You Forget About Me, performed by Simple Minds, reached number 1 on the Billboard Hot 100. Before the ending lines of the movie, there's one more unforgettable scene. The dance!
Almost over.
The assigned essay of Who Do You Think You Are is just about due.
Are you going to write your paper?
Yeah, why?
Well, it's kind of a waste for all of us to write our paper. I think we'd all say the same thing.
You just don't want to write your paper, do you?
True, but you are the smartest. We trust you.
Brian agrees to use the remaining time to finish the paper.
Detention is over, and with that, the teens gather their things and are ready to venture back to the real world.
Hey, 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 ooh, oh, oh.
Dear Mr. Vernon,
we accept the fact that we had to sacrifice a whole Saturday in detention for whatever it was we did wrong. But we think you're crazy to make an essay telling you who we think we are. You see us as you want to see us.
In the simplest terms and the most convenient definitions, but what we found out is that each of us is a brain.
And an athlete.
And a basket case.
A princess.
And a criminal.
Does that answer your question? Don't you forget about me. Sincerely yours, The Breakfast Club.
Good job. We're moving on to our next item, which will be a reader's theater. And since many of the ladies that were in the core reading are also in reader's theater, I'm going to stall for them a minute here. Our state competition will be held at Dubuque Senior. We call it the Castle because when you go to Dubuque Senior High School, it is literally a school made of limestone. It's an older school. Anyway, that's why we call it the Castle. But I don't know if you saw the times that we're performing. It's between 8 o'clock and 11 o'clock on Saturday. So just to remind you, Dubuque's 2 hours away, all right? So we're going to have to leave at 5:15 in the morning to get over there by 7:15 so we can get ready for those 8 o'clock performances. The nice thing is the kids can sleep on the bus on the way there, so it's not too big of a deal. But anyway, we'll do what we can with what we've got. All right, so up next is going to be a reader's theater. Just to forewarn you, this is around 20 to 25 minutes long, so if you needed to use the restroom, now would be a good time to go, but this is called Cinderella versus the Step Family.
The Honorable Judge I. Hingham now presiding.
Thank you very much. You may be seated. The next case is Cinderella versus the Step Family.
Cinderella is suing the Step Family for neglect, verbal and emotional abuse, embezzlement of funds, destruction of property, breaking child labor laws. The Step Family is countersuing for defamation of character, theft, pain and suffering, and animal abuse.
Send the legal representatives forward, please. And you're representing whom?
I am the Step Family's lawyer, Your Honor.
You're new to this courtroom, aren't you? I can always tell a newbie.
I know, Your Honor. B.B. Wolf, attorney at Paw, at your service. I was involved in a case here with you a while back.
Yes. Yes, of course. I thought so. And did you win?
Why else would I be standing before you today?
So you always get your man, huh? We'll see. And is this your mother you brought with you?
No, Your Honor. My mother is more of a backwoods type. This would be the lawyer for Cinderella.
Ah, yes. I know you anywhere. Mrs. Hubbard. So you're busy doing legal work to keep that cupboard full?
Actually, it's Mrs. Shu, and this is my first time in this courtroom, Your Honor. After my children all grew up and got the boot, I decided it was my turn. I wanted excitement, good pay, and fun-filled vacations. So I became a court reporter. Then I studied law, and now I'm a full-time attorney. This case caught my attention because it concerned the abuse of a child. And if there's one thing I know, it's children.
I see. You may begin your opening statements.
Pain, suffering, abandonment, abuse. These are all the things that made up Cinderella's daily life. Her mother died when she was just a baby, and her father died a few short years later. And left alone with a stepfamily who was jealous of her and treated her like a slave. Her stepsisters made fun of her, and her stepmother neglected her. My client still has the emotional scars to bear. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, bring the perpetrators of these hideous crimes to justice by finding in favor of my client.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you are all familiar with Cinderella's rags-to-riches story, but you don't know the real, behind-the-scenes story from the people who lived it with her. Just because Cinderella is a beautiful princess, that doesn't make her right. Sometimes there is cruelty behind an innocent face. just as there can be gentility behind a furry face. I challenge you to look beyond the surface and into the grim reality of the betrayal that my clients have suffered.
You may call your first witness.
I call Cinderella to the stand.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your brothers Grimm?
I do.
Tell us, in your words, what was life like living with your stepfamily?
At first it wasn't so bad, when Daddy was still alive. After Daddy died, my stepmother changed. She made me do all of the housework, while her daughters did no chores at all. They teased me and made more work for me. They used up the money that my father had left behind for me. I was orphaned and had no place to stay except for my stepfamily. I had no place to go.
There, sweetie. Can you tell us about the night of the ball?
Well, the invitation was for everyone. I asked to go. My stepmother made sure I had so many chores to do that there was no way I'd be able to finish in time. If it weren't for the fairy godmother, I would have never made it there.
Did the fairy godmother alter you in any way?
Oh no, not me personally. She dressed me in a lovely gown after my mother's silk dress was ruined by my stepsisters. She gave me the silver slippers and the coach to get there, but that was all.
You had no other good clothes of your own?
No, only rags.
How tragic. And how did your stepsisters ruin your silk dress?
Oh, it was awful. They tore it to shreds. It was the only thing I had left behind by my mother's belongings. I still have nightmares about it. I'll never forget. They ripped it right off my body. Because of that, to this day, I suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder.
Oh, you poor child. Thank you for having the courage to share with us today. No further questions.
Now, Cinderella, you were given regular meals, a room of your own with a fireplace, and a family to live with after the tragic death of your father. Is this correct?
I didn't have my own bedroom. It was a bed put in the family room by the smelly old fireplace.
Wasn't it one of your chores to clean the fireplace?
Well, yes.
Then whose fault was it that it was smelly?
Mine, I suppose, but...
Were there any other bedrooms available?
No.
So you had a private room with a fireplace while your stepsisters had to share a cold room. Did you ever balk at the chores you were asked to do?
Well, yes, I suppose. I did when suddenly I was doing all of the housework. Griselda and Portobello did nothing.
Your poor widowed stepmother took you in and gave you a home with a private room and a fireplace. Your stepfamily could have sent you into foster care, but they took you in. After all they did for you, you weren't willing to do a few simple household chores to help them out?
It wasn't like that. They were mean to me, and they should have to pay for that.
They are fatherless and live in poverty, while you married into the royal family and will live in a castle happily ever after. But you still want them to suffer more?
They tore up the one dress I had just so I couldn't go to the ball.
Yet by magic, you managed to get there anyways. And why did your stepsisters tear up your dress?
As I already stated, just so I couldn't go to the ball.
Really? Do you recognize these?
Yes, those are the decorations they left off the dress.
That's right, decorations that did not belong to you. Baubles you stole from your stepsisters without permission.
I found them in a wastebasket.
You stole them from a storage container and used them without asking. Your stepsisters merely took back what was rightfully theirs.
They threw those things out as trash. You're not telling it right. That's not fair.
Fair, yes. Let's talk about what's fair, shall we? You had a magically woven, amazing gown and silver slippers, the likes of which none of here have ever seen. You had an enchanted coach and coachman. You used the unfair advantage of magic to replace your dress and give you an advantage over the other girls at the ball. Don't whine to me about being fair. Your Honor, I decree that the plaintiff failed to prove damages and the defense therefore requests judgment.
Can he do that? Well, let's see. The prom dress issue, well, that's a bit foggy there. And then there's whether the fairy godmother used magic to change the girl or just her situation. Mr. Wolf, Mrs. Shu, approach the bench. Your movement for judgment is overruled. The witness may be seated. Mrs. Shu, do you have further witnesses?
No, Your Honor.
Mr. Wolf, you may now call your next witness.
I call Lady Trupang, Cinderella's stepmother, to the stand.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you, Brothers Grimm?
Yes.
Lady Trupang, tell the court on how you met Cinderella.
Well, I was just coming off of a bad relationship when I met her father. He was quite charming, and we ended up getting married. Cinderella was part of the deal. I agreed to accept the daughter when I married the father.
Isn't it true that you have continued to clothe, feed, and house Cinderella, even though her father died years ago, and the money he left you is mostly gone?
Yes, that's true. We not only share our home with her, we allow her to keep her pets there, too.
This must be very difficult for you, a widow raising three children all on her own.
It's not easy, but I do the best I can.
And how did you feel when you found out Cinderella was suing you?
It was a slap in the face! I know that compared to her life at the palace, her life with us was hard. But she has everything now. She's a princess, she's rich, so why would she want to take away from us what little we have left? It hurt us all very deeply. Everybody just hears and sees what Cinderella wants them to believe. But I think you're smarter than that.
I'm sure that they are. I know your daughters are also here to testify about this travesty of justice. I won't prolong the suffering. No further questions.
Your witness.
I have some questions. When you married Cinderella's father, he was fairly rich. What happened to all that money?
We used most of it on the girls. Cinderella's father had always spoiled her rotten. She's a pretty thing, I suppose. And my daughters, well, they're beauty challenged, you see.
I heard that.
How rude.
Order!
We had to get braces for Griselda and corrective shoes for Portobello. Then there was the laser eye surgeries, dermatologist appointments, and the rest of the money not used to run the household was set aside for the cosmetic surgery when my daughters come of age.
I am not getting plastic surgery.
Cinderella doesn't need any of these things done. I only wanted what was best for my daughters. Wouldn't any mother want that?
Didn't her father leave that money for Cinderella in his will?
He never took the time to have a proper will made, so everything that was his came to me. I saw to it that Cinderella had what she needed, but I didn't spoil her. I wanted to prepare her for the real world. I'm sure to her it felt harsh, but I did the best I could by her, and I was a grieving widow myself.
The best you could by her. You dressed her in rags while your daughters wore fine dresses.
I didn't want her to ruin her mother's silk dress by making her wear that when she did her chores. A few chores were all that I asked of her. My poor dears are just too fragile to do housework. Griselda's allergic to dust mites, and Portobello gets dizzy smelling toilet bowl cleaners. My daughters have so much to deal with already. So yes, I let them wear their pretty dresses around the house. It's good for their self-esteem.
You gave Cinderella no time off and no way to go to the ball.
Nonsense. I told her that she could go to the ball as soon as she was done with her chores. And she had her mother's silk dress to wear. She chose to lollygag. That's not my fault. She wasn't ready to go when we left, but the castle was just up the hill and not a long walk from the house.
She had no friends. You let her run around with rodents.
Those were her pets?
And isn't it true that she was forced to sleep in ashes while your daughters had a bedroom?
Cinderella had her own room, what used to be the family room, and slept by the fireplace so she was nice and warm. My daughter shared a bedroom that had no fireplace.
But you put the fire out every night.
Well, yes, for fire safety reasons. But the radiant heat would warm her for hours.
Cold ashes. You left her in cold ashes at night. What kind of a mother are you? Utterly disgusting. I can't even look at you right now. No further questions.
This court declares a brief recess.
Yay! Duck, duck, goose!
Duck, duck, duck,
goose!
Duck. Duck.
Goose!
Duck, duck, duck,
goose!
You may call your next witness.
I call the page to the stand.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help your brothers Grimm?
Yes, I do.
Is it true that you went from house to house with a silver slipper, putting it on the foot of all the maidens in the kingdom, trying to sniff out the girl who had lost it?
Yes, that's true. And let me tell you, when you say lost it, you're not kidding. I think she may have a phobia about clocks or something, because as soon as the clock struck midnight, she completely wigged out. I'm talking loony bin material here. Left the prince standing there, ran off, hair flying everywhere. Didn't even stop to get her shoe. Personally, I think she's totally psycho, but you know, if that's what his highness is-
I was referring to the slipper. Weren't you going from place to place, attempting to find the girl who had lost her slipper?
Oh, why, yes. Yes, I was.
Isn't it also true that just before you tried the shoe on Cinderella, you tripped and broke the slipper into pieces?
Well, yes. So obviously it was only silver-plated, and not the real thing. But she had the other one in her pocket.
Who's to say that it wasn't the true match? Without both slippers, how can we be sure? Of course the shoe she pulled from her pocket would fit her, but that wasn't the shoe you'd been trying on all the other girls, now was it?
No, but it was a perfect match.
Well, she did have a fairy godmother at her disposal, so she could have conjured something up at the last minute. No further questions.
Have you ever before seen a pair of silver slippers or know of any cobblers in town who could make one?
Cobbler? Cobbler? What kind? Peach? Apple? That's my favorite. Where is it? Can we eat it now? Is there whipped cream?
It's not that kind of cobbler, Your Honor.
What was the question again?
Do you know of any shoe cobblers who could make silver slippers like those Cinderella had?
No.
Did you see a fairy godmother anywhere nearby when you were at Cinderella's home?
No, nobody knew that we'd be there.
So, in your opinion, would there have been enough time between the ball and your visit to her house to have a shoe like that specifically made out of town?
Certainly not.
Which leads us to the conclusion that the only way she could have had the silver slipper in her pocket that day was if she still carried it from the night before when she wore it at the ball. No further questions.
You may call your next witness.
I'd like to call the three mice to the stand.
They aren't blind, are they?
Different mice, Your Honor.
Good. I don't believe in blind justice.
But you don't have to allow them up here if you don't want them.
Objection, Your Honor. Animals can't testify. Nobody can understand them.
That's true.
Oh, it's all right, Your Honor. I'll translate for you. I squeak fluent mouse.
Oh, well, in that case, I'll allow it. Overruled.
Objection, Your Honor.
Can you do that?
I hope so, ma'am. You see, I have a...
What's that?
I'm a bit squeamish when it comes to... Well,
come on now, spit it out. Time's a-wasting.
I'm afraid of mice.
Oh, well, that changes everything.
Your Honor.
I mean, that changes nothing. Buck up, old chap. The mice won't touch you. Will you now?
Okay. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your brother's group? Squeak, squeak!
Squeak, squeakity, squeak gums, squeak-a-doodle, squeaker.
Squeak, squeak!
I asked them if it's true that the stepsisters forced Cinderella to do their housework. They said yes, that the stepsisters were lazy and mean to Cinderella every day. They witnessed the cruel treatment every day.
Objection, Your Honor! How do we know that's what the mice really said?
Objection sustained. There's no way we can know for sure. The jury will forget about the last testimony. The mice can return to their holes.
But, Your Honor, I can assure
you... That's enough. Call your next witness.
I call Griselda and Portabella to the stand.
I got here first.
Only because you pushed me.
Place your right hand on the book, please.
Ha! Beat you.
That's not fair. You were closer. Mom!
Order in the court.
Now. Temper.
Girls, behave.
Yes, Mother.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your brothers Grimm?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, girls, isn't it true that Cinderella had to do all of your chores on a regular basis?
Yes, we have a rare disease that renders us unable to do chores.
Yes, a horrible allergy to household cleaners.
We're environmentally sensitive.
That's not true. They're lazy.
You see?
So you would do your part if you could, but you have no choice other than to ask Cinderella, who is a part of this family, to help you in your hour of need.
Precisely.
And she complained about that.
As if it was our fault we're sick.
Tell us about the night of the ball.
She was awful. She stole our beads and sashes.
She tried to pretend they were hers.
But we knew that they were ours, and we took them off of her.
That little thief.
Who knew she had a fairy godmother hanging around?
Yeah, that old witch. She's probably who made us sick.
No further questions.
Your witnesses?
Isn't it true that you'd thrown away the beads and sash that Cinderella was using?
We weren't using them that night, but we never told her she could use them.
So you're environmentally sensitive, are you? What happens when you try to, say... scrub a bathtub?
It's awful.
Terrible.
We break out the pain and agony.
I know the pain of acne can be a problem, but...
Not acne, agony.
I don't think you break out at all. I think you just made that up so you could make poor Cinderella here your slave. Am I right? How's this powder?
Order in the court! Security, assist these girls!
She did that on purpose. I'm gonna sue!
We're already in a lawsuit, you ninny.
Order in the court! Order in the court!
There. Now, calm down. Make nice, you two.
Yes, girls.
Be good in front of the jury, please.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I submit to you that this is all an act. There is no real reason for these two lazy girls to dump all of their chores onto Cinderella at all. No further questions.
You may be seated.
Next witness.
I call the fairy godmother to the stand.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your brothers Grimm?
Naturally. You are Cinderella's fairy godmother. Please tell the court the conditions you found Cinderella living in when you came into her life.
It was atrocious. She was buried in housework, wearing rags, and not even given a room of her own to sleep in.
She only had a bed by the fireplace. If it weren't for the pet animal she was friends with, she'd have no friends at all. How any mother could allow such a sweet child to live in such squalor is beyond me.
And what did you do to help her?
I made sure she could go to the ball. I knew when she was there, she'd be able to win the prince over. I gave her everything she needed to be the prettiest girl there.
Without your assistance, where would Cinderella probably be today?
She would have never made it to the ball and would still be living in that squalor and enduring the daily abuse of her stepfamily.
No further questions.
I have some questions. You said you gave Cinderella everything she needed to go to the ball. How'd you do this?
I'm a fairy, after all. I made sure her housework was done and gave her a coach, horses, a driver, and a footman. And I gave her a dress and slippers unlike anyone had ever seen before. I'm quite proud of that part, actually.
And how did you do all of this?
With my magic wand, of course. Now, where did I put that silly thing? Ah, here it is.
Then it was through magic that Cinderella was able to go to the ball where the prince fell in love with her. Without your magic, we have no way of knowing whether the prince would have fallen for Cinderella or not, do we?
I did nothing to the girl herself. I simply gave her proper clothing and transportation for the evening and saw to it that her chores were done.
Are you sure that's all you did?
Pardon me?
Oh, I know all about you and your bibbidi-bobbidi-boo.
Don't take that tone with me or I'll bop your Alkazoo.
Judge, this is a hostile witness and she should be removed from the court.
I haven't done anything to you yet. You want hostile? I'll show you hostile.
Order! Order in the court.
Ma'am, place the wand on the floor and back away slowly.
Don't you tell me what to do, little nipper. You young whippersnappers need to learn to respect your elders.
Now, you're excited. Here. Take the Zolift. It'll even out those mood swings.
The guard is a toad.
Ruh. Oh, what were the words that spell? You stay away from me. Security, help, security.
That was security.
Madam, I find you in contempt of court.
Take her to the slammer.
Abracazoo, Alcadabra. Oh, where is my spell book?
Now you may call your next witness.
I have no more witnesses, Your Honor.
Then you may call your next witness.
I'm done too, Your Honor.
Of course. I knew that. Well then, closing statements.
As it is easy to see, several crimes have been committed by the stepfamily against poor Cinderella. All the pain and abuse has been proven by the testimonies by the witnesses here today. Just because Cinderella married well, it doesn't mean that the years of suffering and abuse are suddenly not a crime. Child abuse is a crime. Neglect is a crime. Emotional torment is a crime. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, there is no option today but to find in favor of Cinderella.
We have proven that Cinderella was no more than a spoiled child. She was unwilling to help her ailing stepsisters with the chores and was a constant problem to her poor widowed stepmother. She was lucky enough to marry a prince, which has enabled her to continue the torment of my clients. She kept germ-ridden rodents in the house, knowing how sickly her stepsisters were, and she used magic to win over the prince. Cinderella's story has been glamorized by Hollywood professionals time and time again. My clients didn't have the ability to get their story out until today. Don't be fooled again. You must free my long-suffering clients today by releasing the stepfamily and finding Cinderella guilty as charged.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you have heard the testimonies of both sides, and now it is your turn to decide. When I count to three, if you are in favor of the stepfamily, yell out stepfamily. If you are in favor of Cinderella, yell out Cinderella. Ready? One, two, three.
Cinderella!
Cinderella wins!
Why? What have I done wrong to deserve this? Where is my fairy godmother? Is there no justice in this world? And as for you, you pitiful, flea-bitten excuse for a lawyer.
I beg your pardon?
Oh, Mother, stop the dramatics. We lost. Now let's see if we can sue that lawyer for excessive trickery.
Really, Mother, you're embarrassing us.
Heed your daughters. It's very important to control your impulses. In front of a judge, anyway.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, thank you for coming to do your civic duty today. This concludes this trial of the fairy tale courtroom.
Okay, that was the Reader's Theater, and we're going to be moving on to musical theater. As you can imagine, this category is based on song and singing a musical, and The three songs will be coming from the musical Calvin Burger. So I bet you could imagine if we were to take Lauren Carney, Bella Sessler, Johnny Ward, and Jonah Carney and tell them, get up in front of people and sing, that would be pretty good. You would be right. Go ahead, fasten your seatbelts. Here's Calvin Burger.
Calvin Burger is a story about four teenagers. Calvin.
Brett. Rosanna.
Matt.
All of them struggling with their inner selves and relationships with others. Of all organs be well endowed, look at it. First thing I see when I wake up every morning. First thing anyone sees when they first notice me. How can I expect Rosanna, the prettiest girl in the school, to like me or to even notice me when God parked Mount Everest on my face? My parents say I should be less insecure, but when you're 17 and it's the one thing keeping you from her, a giant schnoz is a pretty big deal. Less insecure, that's what they say. But I'm in high school, let's face it, every day is judgment day. So what's my fate? I'll have to wait. And holy crap, it's almost 7:58. I can't be late on the first day of school. You know, other kids are so lucky they don't have to deal with things like this.
I hate my ass. It is my jinx. It must be made of polyester, cause it never ever shrinks. The fattest ass.
Oh,
Rosanna's in the study hall too?
Why are you so obsessed with her?
What are you talking about? I'm not obsessed with her. What? What?
Don't you think every one of us sees that you're different when she's in the room?
No, I'm not.
This is not such a mystery. We don't need Scooby-Doo. Calvin, everyone knows what you're feeling, but you...
What I'm feeling is that you're on crack.
Don't you think it's a bit of a sign that your room is a shrine to Rosanna?
A few pictures.
Don't you think it's a little bizarre that you drew a big R on...
That's for
a wrestle. It's a normal emotion. We don't need Dr. Phil. But if you honestly need me to say it, I will. You're in love.
All right, Brett, that's enough. Brett, people are staring. Can you at least get to the V? Can you at least get to the V, please? Hey.
You're in love.
Brett, no, please. I beg you, please! Okay, I admit it! Maybe a tiny crush.
You know, you're not the only one who has feelings.
What are you talking about? Of course I care about your feelings.
Forget it.
Thank you.
We are now to the part of the program where there's an ensemble with Tessa Stroh and Madison Morris. They'll be performing A Banquet of Friendship.
Where is she? She tells me to be here right at noon and it's 10 after. Come on, Pat, be on time just once.
Been waiting long?
No, it's my fault. I should have known not to be on time for you.
I was just picking up a few vitamins.
Do you ever eat, like, real food?
I'm meeting you for lunch, aren't I?
I suppose. Come on, the line's getting shorter. Oh, baby, time to pig out.
Do you have to say it like that?
Like what?
Pig out, I mean, we've got to take care of our bodies.
I am. Mind saying, feed me, baby, feed me.
Disgusting.
Wow, look at all this food.
Fat city.
Look, I have starved myself for 2 days to get with this feast. I'm not gonna pay this price for bean sprouts and tofu. Aren't you eating?
The salads are right down there.
Oh, geez, you know it's a good thing we're best friends or we wouldn't get along at all.
Yeah, it's nice meeting together every week for something.
And this is the first time I've convinced you to go out somewhere to eat.
I'm careful what all I eat.
Me too, I eat it all. Hey, look, there's a table over there.
Lead the way.
Only room for a few desserts on this plate. I'll go back later.
I'm sure you will.
What is that supposed to be?
I'm sure you will, that's all.
Okay.
Do you know how many grams of fat are in that salad dressing?
Huh?
Do you know how many grams of fat you're eating there?
Gee, no, I must have swallowed the label. Of course I don't know how many grams of fat there are in my salad dressing. I know how many grams of taste there are, and that's why I'm eating it.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Good, me too.
Over 75 grams.
Stop that!
What?
I told you not to mention it.
Look, I'm sorry, I just hate to see you stuffing all that—
What? See me what?
Stuffing all that fat into your body.
It's my body, it's my fatty body. Let me stuff it if I want to stuff it.
People are beginning to stare at us.
It's all that fat in their body. Fat makes you stare a lot.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Good, me too. Let's just enjoy our meals, not each other's meals. Our own meals, and then get out of here.
Fine.
Great.
What? What's the matter? Something wrong with your carrots? I have something unbuttoned.
What?
It's saturated fat at that.
Oh my gosh.
It's saturated fat the worst way.
I'm about to give you some mashed potatoes in the worst way if you don't stop that.
Look, I'm sorry. If I'd known you react like this, I—
Me? Like it's my fault?
The manager is staring at us.
The manager isn't looking at us. He's looking at you. You're ruining his business. A table of five just ran up to join that freaking health club without paying for their fatty food.
Listen, I'm just talking science here.
And I'm talking justifiable homicide. Friend murders friend in local buffet. Stabbed to death with sharpened celery stalk as nude crowd cheers.
Look, I'm sorry. If I'd known you react like this, I wouldn't—
Me? Like it's my fault?
Sorry, I'm sorry. I'll just sit here. I won't say anything.
Good. Just let me eat my food. Sheesh, we should have gone to a movie.
And while you've got your mouth full, I should let you know that there's less than 1 gram of protein in your entire mouth at the moment. No calcium, iron, vitamin C, or A. And the calories from fat is nearly 50%.
What?
Go ahead, keep eating. Look at that lasagna. Potassium sorbate, glutamate, lactic acid, alginate, and enough monosodium glutamate to keep it fresh until the dinner crowd gets here. I'd say about 1,400 calories. Almost double what you should be eating all day long. I mean, I'm sorry. I just feel it's my duty as your friend to let you know what you're doing to your body. I mean, I can just sit here and let you eat yourself into a fatty grave. I can— What are you doing? What are you doing, Jean? Are you going to hurt me? If you're going to hurt me, then I'm calling the manager.
The manager? He pay me for what I'm about to do.
Look, Jean, calm down. I'm sorry. If I'd known you react, I'm sorry.
Prepare to die!
Are you nuts?
Nuts! Do you know how many grams of fat there are in the average handful of nuts?
Stop, Jean, listen, it's not funny. If you're being funny,
I'm not laughing. See, no ha ha ha, nothing. Not funny.
Yes, it is, Pat. Can't you see I'm laughing, Pat? Listen to me. Ha ha ha!
Look, I'm sorry.
You should be. This is my food. This is my dinner. You're ruining it with your freaking health report. Let me live off bean curds and celery, but let me die of banana pie poisoning. I'm not upset. I'm ready to drown you in your lettuce soup.
I'm sorry, okay? What are you doing with that? What are you doing?
Look at this drumstick, Pat. Can't you see? Look at this little drumstick. Why would they do this to the little drumstick, Pat?
Are you going to hit me with that? Is that what you're going to do?
No, Pat. I'm not going to hit you with it.
You're going to make me eat it. You're going to make me eat that calorie-crammed, fat, greasy little drumstick, aren't you?
No, Pat. I'm not going to make you eat this fat, little, crammed drumstick. I'm going to make you watch me eat it!
Oh! Mm-hmm. I can't watch this!
Oh, yes, you can, and watch this!
Lasagna!
Yummy, Mommy, bring me more!
No!
Baked beans, fettuccine alfredo, whipped cream! Look at this, Pat! Listen to the little fat Graham screaming! You know what that sound is? That is the sound of pure, undietary, insane happiness, Pat! Happiness! Happiness!
You make me sick!
No, you make me sick! Listen to all your freaking health food lectures! Let me live off bean curds and celery, but let me die of banana pie poisoning!
Jean? Jean, are you okay? Jean, listen to me, say something!
Hot fudge sundae.
What?
Hot fudge sundae with whipped cream.
You're sick.
But happy, Pat. Very, very happy.
I'm leaving.
Can I have your dessert, though?
Bye.
What about next week?
Next week?
We meet every week.
I wouldn't.
A movie. We'll see a movie.
I suppose.
Popcorn!
Jean!
Popcorn with milk duds!
Oh.
Until then, stay healthy.
Turn to the person next to you and talk in a British accent. Seriously, go ahead. Are you ready for some British talking? It's gonna be great. Nope. They say in the back room it's a tough crowd out here. You guys ain't laughing much. So you start talking British and everyone's laughing now. That's good. Explains my bad teeth. Oh, now you're laughing. I make fun of myself and you laugh. I get it. All right. Anywho, we've got Queen Marie and Agnes' fateful journey through the woods.
Come on, Queen Marie. At this rate, we'll never get there. Oh, Agnes, I'm so tired. Will you carry me?
No, I will not carry you. As you can see, I'm already carrying every measly thing we own.
And I would not, because you have two perfectly good feet.
You're right. They are perfect. Perfect, pretty, petite little feet. And on these feet, I will walk all the way to King Henry's castle.
Try not to lag behind. We've got to stick together. These woods, they could be dangerous.
Oh, Agnes, I was just thinking about how much I love King Henry. Let me count the ways.
Please don't. They've been counted and recounted and nauseousome.
Oh, Agnes, you just don't understand.
Of course I don't. It's stupid. You met him once.
It was love at first sight. Isn't that the best kind?
That's not sensible. You saw him all at once.
True love has nothing to do with senses. That's for common folk.
Isn't that why they call it common sense?
We wouldn't want that. We'd rather be walking through these woods. We don't even know where we're going, and King Henry doesn't even know we're coming, so if we get attacked by whatever wild things are out here, no one will ever know.
We would have died for love, Agnes. Isn't that beautiful?
No, I wouldn't.
Oh, how I love him! With a love that is so fervent, so abiding, and so elated that it makes me feel guilty for
lying to him.
Lie to him? What did you lie to him about?
He thinks I'm rich.
What? I cannot tell him the truth. If I tell him the truth, he might not want to marry me.
He'll find out soon enough.
Well, yes, but by then we'd already be married and living at his castle. And besides, he loves me madly and therefore won't care if I'm poor. And Agnes, money isn't the most important thing.
I know it isn't. Food is.
Love is. Love is the most important thing.
Only if you're not hungry.
Well, when someone is hungry for love, nothing else matters.
Then why don't you tell him the truth?
True love has nothing to do with the truth. The truth just confuses things.
Agnes, this is just wrong.
When I saw him riding on his stallion, so refined, so elegant,
so handsome,
so rich.
And I saw him at my window, and he saw me, and I saw him, and we saw we. And he pulled back the reins of his horse to stare longingly into my face.
And he pulled back the reins so fast that he flew into the pig pen.
Yes, but how he flew was such an elegant affair.
I don't think anyone could fly into a pig slop with such an elegant flair.
I believe you're making fun.
There's no fun in this job, Queen Marie, believe me.
You know, Agnes, I feel suddenly to write a poem. A love poem.
Oh, goody.
Agnes, what rhymes with love?
Shove.
King Henry, my love, myself at you I shove. That doesn't sound right.
Sounds not right to me.
Oh, Agnes, you're just not a romantic. My eyes seek you and only you. Okay, what rhymes with only you?
Bony stew?
My eyes seek you and only you. My love for you is like bony stew? Agnes, that's like saying my love for him is like a pot of bony beef. A bony stew? You're no help at all.
Well, I'm sorry if I am no help. I'm too busy feeding the chickens and chopping firewood and brushing your hair and bathing you and sewing for you and cooking and cleaning. So I am sorry if I am no help. Oh, it's my have to do everything for myself.
Henry, Henry, Bo Benry, Banana, Fana, Fo Fenry, Fee, Fi, Mo, Menry,
my Henry.
Isn't that beautiful?
Bo Benry, what is a Bo Benry?
It's called a poetic license, Agnes. Well, I can't wait to show King Henry my poem.
Let's get a move on.
Okay. Ow! It's my back! I can't walk! I can't move! Oh, no! Is it better now? No! Last time this happened, I was in bed for 2 days.
Oh, let me help you sit.
Ow. 2 days?
If not more, you can never tell.
Oh, I don't know what to do. I want to go to King Henry's castle and get married. Agnes, I just had the best idea ever. Would you be okay if I went to King Henry's castle, got married, and then got you after the wedding?
Let's see. I'm in the middle of the forest. I have no food, no water, and I can't walk. What could go wrong?
Well, I believe it's incredibly brave of me to walk all the way to King Henry's castle by myself.
That's true. You've never done anything by yourself. Go on, then.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Here. This to keep you warm.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
mind, miss. I just thought of something.
What is it?
When I gave you my shawl, just now, that was the first time I'd ever done anything for you.
Or anybody, really. No argument there.
I'm gonna think about that as I'm walking.
All right. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Oh, Agnes, I can't leave you here. What's happening to me?
I believe it's called conscience.
Oh, I don't like it.
Then go?
No, I can't. We'll starve or get eaten by wild things. Here, together.
You'll stay with me. Really?
Yes.
That, dear Queen Marie, is what love is.
You're right. It feels good in a really scary and full of dread sort of way.
Well, let's go then.
Your back is better. It's a miracle.
No, it was a lie. I was pretending.
I am really, really, really mad at you. You lied to me.
Uh-huh.
That was despicable behavior, Agnes.
Like you're going to lie to King Henry is despicable.
Oh, I guess that's the same thing. I'm so confused. When your mother died,
God rest her soul.
I promised her I'd take care of you, and I did, but I guess I forgot to teach you that to be a good and honest person is the most important thing of all.
I'm a horrible person.
Oh, no, you're not. You were going to stay with me.
Yes, I was, because I love you, Agnes.
And I love you, and if you love King Henry...
Oh, I do, Agnes.
Then I'll tell him the truth.
Good, let's go then. Oh, Agnes, I feel the urge to write a poem again. Dear King Henry, know this for sure. My heart is rich, though my kingdom is poor.
Do you think you could do that while we're walking?
Oh, let me get the bags for you.
Oh, okay.
Dear King Henry, know this for sure. My heart is rich, though my kingdom is poor. But now and forever, my love is yours. Pure, honest, simple, and getting mature. And you said you couldn't write a poem?
That was Bella Sessler and Ada Switzer. And we will now have Ella Butcher and Layla Wessels performing Acting Up.
Please, just give me a break. Just one break, and I won't bother you ever again, ever.
Look, honey, we've been through this before. I just don't have any work for you. It's a tough economy. Everybody's cutting back on their advertising.
But I'm good. I'm really good. Please, just give me a chance.
They're all good. Now look, I have a 1 o'clock appointment, so just leave your number with my secretary.
The dragon must die!
Huh?
Oh, thou most wretched of beasts, doubt'st thou not know that even now thy sword lies claim to thy ugly heart?
What sword? Are you crazy?
And the crowd cheers as the noble Sir Galahad slays the beast!
Help! Somebody help in here!
Well, what'd you think?
Am I dead? What was that?
It was Sir Galahad and the Green Dragon of Miller's Pond. I was in third grade and I was Sir Galahad.
Well, I think you're nuts.
Oh, I can do that too. Want to see my claw, the crazy little gopher?
No, I want to see your nutty actor who walked out the door.
Nutty actor who? I don't know that one. Do you have a script?
Look, if I give you a quick audition, would you just leave me alone?
Yes, yes. But trust me, I won't be leaving you alone. You'll be after me to be in movies and TV shows.
Yeah, yeah, whatever. The only thing I have right now is a commercial.
The open road! The wind in your hair. The power at your fingertips. Drive the new 2024 Lincoln Mercedes. You'll never drive the same old roads again.
Get out of the car!
What?
Get out of the car! It's not a car commercial!
Oh. Can I leave it parked here?
Just get out!
Jewelry? A girl's best friend. Love comes and goes, but diamonds are forever.
Dog food.
Huh?
Dog food. It's a dog food commercial.
That's it?
Honey, if you're a dog, that means a lot. Now take a look at the script.
Oh, I don't need a script. Just tell me how I'm supposed to feel.
You're supposed to feel a burning desire to read the script. Now take a look. It's a 30-second spot. We open with a wide shot of a nice little home with a nice little yard in a nice little town.
And a nice little dog?
Your one sharp cookie and all that. Anyways, the happy music comes in under. Not you!
Oh.
The camera pans in on this dog in the front yard. He's sitting there.
How can you know that it's a he?
I saw his driver's license. Now, would you just read the script? Anyways, he's sitting there bored to death. But then this girl dog walks by.
It's romance?
No, it's a commercial. A dog food commercial. The girl dog sees him. He sees the girl dog. His eyes light up. His tail begins to wag. And he takes a step towards her.
Can you show this on television?
Then you step out of the front door holding a bowl of Frisky Whiskies.
I do not like that name.
Well, too bad, because they're paying the bill. You yell, "Here, boy!" The dog looks at you, looks at the girl dog, and comes running to the bowl of dog food, while a voiceover says, "Sometimes you just gotta decide."
That's it?
That's it.
I say, "Here, boy," and that's it.
That's plenty. The dog does the rest anyways.
Okay, but how do I say it?
What do you mean, how do I say it? You say like you have a stupid bowl of dog food. This is not the Gettysburg Address.
Yeah, I need motivation.
Well, then you're fired.
What? But I gotta have this job.
There's your motivation. Now let's give it a shot.
What? Right here? Right now? Without preparation? Oh, Jesus, it's really hot in here.
You don't need preparation to say, "Here, boy." Believe me, it's easy.
Okay, just.
What are you doing?
I'm getting ready.
But I just
said. I'm not preparing. I'm just getting ready.
Okay, you're ready, you're ready. The boy dog looks at the girl dog. Then you say,
"What kind of dog is he?"
What?
I mean, like, the breed. He's my dog, I should know.
He's a hungry dog. That's what kind he is. The kind that belong to actors who've been fired.
If you were an artist, you'd understand these things.
If I were an artist, I'd paint the ceiling. But I'm an actor, and I try to get artists head on straight. Now say the line. And?
Well, I mean, it would really help me if... Could you be the dog?
What?
The dog. I mean, I need something to concentrate my energy to when I need the dog.
Have you ever considered a career in real estate?
Would I get more lines?
Ugh. Arf! Arf!
You know, dogs don't really say arf.
Well, this one does. Arf! Now say your line!
Okay. But could you tell me what the dog is thinking?
He's thinking he'd like to bite your leg. Oh, look, a cute little girly dog. I think I'll go ask her out for a Coke. Okay, now say your line. Oh. Here!
dog food commercials to a whole new level.
Believe me, it already has.
So I got the part?
You've got the part.
Believe me, you've got the part.
Now here's the director's address. Show up at 9 in the morning and tell him I sent you.
I can't say enough.
Oh, yes, yes you can.
Today, dog food. Tomorrow, Hollywood.
Yeah, go get him, Rover. Mary, call Steve Scheister and tell him I'm sending him an actress for the Frisky Whiskey commercial. What? Well, yeah, I know I said I'd never work with that deadbeat again. The jerk owes me for the last 3 jobs. But tomorrow he'll get everything he deserves.
To the section of our showcase where we're doing group mime. And so what you're going to see here is no words. They're going to be showing off their miming ability through their facial expressions. And then miming is basically acting and showcasing those acting abilities without using words. The title of this piece is called Dance Thieves. That was Lauren Carney, Ada Switzer, Kaysen Titi, and Sierra Sessler doing Dance Thieves. Up next is band tryouts with Savannah Henniger, Lila Reitz, and Alex Dennis. Thank you. That's right, it is improv time.
Yeah.
Thanks, I appreciate that. All right, these guys need a lot of laughs from you guys. So this is the part of the showcase where they have no idea what they're doing. All right, so it could be a total flop, or it could be hilarious. And you guys came for the hilarious part, right?
No.
Yeah.
No.
So you better laugh it up if it's funny. And if it's not, laugh even harder at them, all right? So they were in the back. They drew some topics, and they had to pick one of them. And the topic that they chose was story time at preschool.
Oh, gosh.
Hello, teacher.
What do you want?
It's for you to
eat
us.
It's morning time.
We're waiting to learn.
Huh, I bet. So, today is story day.
Oh,
I love story day. I love story day.
Calm down, okay?
Sorry, teach.
Today we're gonna read The Hungry, Hungry
Hippo
Moth, because we don't want copyright infringement. Yeah, okay. There once was a hungry, hungry moth.
Whoa.
He was so hungry that they called him hungry twice.
Whoa. Hungry, hungry?
I think he's pretty hungry.
Oh, I think he's pretty hungry.
You guys don't want to read a book about this, do you?
No.
Not really.
You should read a book about the two knights and the cupid.
Oh, that's a good one.
I've read that
good
15
one.
Times.
So that's still a good one. Read it.
Read it.
Okay, I'm going.
I'm so excited.
I love this book.
There was two knights. Two knights.
Wait. Don't fairy tale stories start with once upon a time?
You're not supposed to be this smart.
Oh, sorry.
Once upon a time. There was two knights. Two brave knights.
I am a brave knight.
I am very brave too.
And not only were they two very brave knights.
Very brave.
While wearing shiny armor.
Mm-hmm. They had problems with each other.
See, when I come here, okay, that when you say my mother's pie is not good, I can't deal with you.
You don't like my mom's tater tot casserole.
No, I don't. It's too much green beans.
Oh, I can't stand you. You make my blisters bubble.
Oh, I can't stand you.
They ended up getting so angry that they just walked away. And after the two knights had left, here came a man named Cupid. The little ginger boy fluttered away. He fluttered and fluttered and guess what? He kept on fluttering. But then he stopped. And he said,
I'm Cupid.
Indeed he was. The two knights came back in their fit of rage.
There you are. No, don't start with me right now.
You're right.
I'm Cupid. I sense you two are mad at each other.
How could you tell?
Because you're yelling at each other.
Yes.
Would you like me to change that?
And though they were skeptical about that sentence he just said, he continued to flutter and flutter and flutter all around. Can't you see him fluttering?
I'm still angry.
Me too. I can change that. Would you like me to?
Yes. Why not? That?
Why not?
Finally,
Cupid
shot both with his bow and arrow, and
made them
fall in love.
I love you!
Friendship!
Oh my gosh!
Oh, I see the light now. Friends forever.
The love came so strong, though, that it killed each other.
Romeo and Juliet, yes, that is what we are now.
Oh!
Though Cupid knew his mistake was vital, he went over to the bodies as he fluttered and reassured them. All right, and that was the story of the Kardashians.
That was Nick Nigro, Colbin Hoppenworth, Harris Oakes, and Jonah Carney doing group improv. Yeah, that was good. All right, we've got our oldest group of group improv coming out here. Johnny Ward, Corbin Stroh, Alex Engledew, and Landon Reynolds. Hey, what was the topic you guys drew?
A train robbery.
Mrs. Abbas has your time down here, front row.
If you fall off stage, that's my fault. No, if you fall off stage, it's part of the plot. Wait, set the.
Should we put this one down? Guys.
Gotta get on this train before it's too late.
All right, sir.
Why don't you go first? We need to make sure it's safe, you know?
All right.
Go!
10 points.
All right. Remember what I told you, right?
No.
Okay. Game plan. We need to go up to every car, and we need to inspect every person and act as if we are offering them drinks and food. And in the meantime, I just need you to steal the stuff off their wrists. You know, watches, earrings, that type of stuff. Make it real and conspicuous. You know how to do that, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm perfect at this.
Hey, what was that noise?
Oh,
swear I heard a song. Hey, howdy, y'all. How are you doing today?
Hello there, passenger. That's a very fine wristwatch you got there.
Why, thank you, sir. I bought it myself. You know, after years of hard working in the mines, I have something to finally show how great I am as a miner.
Can I offer you a beverage?
A beverage? What kind of beverages do you offer?
Moonshine.
Oh, I love moonshine. Give it to me.
Hard liquor.
Great. You know, perfect thing to, you know, relax the nerves as you get off the mines.
Thank you. We're overpricing the liquor.
Is there a problem back there?
That'll be $50.
50 plus tax.
Excuse me.
Do you accept returns?
No.
Excuse me, this is my train, and I made it very well clear there's no moonshine allowed. Alright? Especially ones for $50.
Oh, was that underpriced?
No. Actually, it's a little bit overpriced. Are you trying to drive me out of business?
My bad.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Alright.
Won't happen again.
Anyway, what are you even on here?
Why aren't you taking his wristwatch? Oh, we're just here to serve the passengers, as you know, as you did hire us.
I didn't hire nothing.
Wrong wrist.
But if you're doing me a service, I'm not going to say no.
So, you know, the beautiful sight out there, all those windows. Just roaming through the countryside.
That's a mountain.
Oh.
You can barely see anything.
Oh. I didn't realize that.
I got the wristwatch.
Oh, where my wrist was called?
That is an excellent question.
Yeah. I don't know where it went.
Just the thing that happened to me.
It's on my wrist.
Wait a minute. Are you missing a wristwatch? Because I swear it wasn't wearing one a second ago.
Yes, sir, I am missing a wristwatch.
You have very fine perception, sir. How did you tell?
I think I can tell something else. Come on. All right. So, I haven't told anyone this, but I'm actually a part-time police officer.
You're a part-time police?
Shh! We can't let them know. I know these guys.
Is everything all right up there?
Ruined tootily.
Yes.
I heard part-time pizza parlor.
Yeah. All right, so basically, I can't make an arrest of this, all right? Because this is my train conductor's outfit.
Oh, of course, you need to be in your police officer outfit.
Ah, there you go.
Yeah.
All right, so I basically just need you to keep them talking, whatever, while I go get changed.
Right, of course.
Yeah, so you go and do that. I'll just walk by right past you.
Hello? I'm still a passenger. Oh, wait, who's gonna conduct the train? Anyway, hey guys! So, what brings you over here to, what is this train station called again? I forget. You know, I'm so clumsy. Keep thinking. Just think long and hard, you know?
I got a question.
We have all the time in the world. At least 2 minutes.
I got a question for you real quick. So, about that moonshine that you drank earlier, you never did pay for it.
Oh, the moonshine?
Yeah.
Oh, so... What if I didn't have the money?
It's a very fine hat you got there. I'd bet that'd fetch at least 60.
Guys, I remembered something. It's the Continental Express.
Good job, buddy.
That's real important, isn't it?
Mr. Conductor! Mr. Conductor!
Hey, everybody on the ground!
Whoa!
Yep, you weren't expecting the dual-time police officer. Gets them every time.
What are you doing on the ground?
What are you doing on the ground?
I don't know. I think you've got
him. You should be on the ground.
My bad. I
apologize.
That's
what I thought. Yeah. Make sure to apologize real and good to the county.
You were the conductor, were you not?
Yeah, I was.
Yes.
What about
so,
it?
Who's conducting the train?
That's a great question.
All right, that was our group improv wrapping it up, but we do have two more things to show here. We have a short film and then a TV news to show. Those are both pre-recorded events, so hope you enjoy.
I really hope this job goes well for me. The pay is insane.
Took you long enough.
Sorry, I was pulling my hair. Had it look spiffy for the first day.
Don't worry, you won't last here too long anyway.
It's not supposed to be.
Most of the trainees were cut on the first day. And others didn't come back.
They never came back? Why?
I guess there's something about ghost. Well, of course, you have nothing to worry about, because there's no such thing as ghosts. Unless you get spooked easily.
Did you see that?
See what? The lights? It happens all the time. Now help me pick up this broom, won't you? My back ain't what it used to be. Like I said, if you get spooked easily, these are your average working conditions, so get used to it. Follow me, I'll show you the ropes. Let me see. You start mopping the floor while I find this thing.
Yes, sir. Why are you leaving this job, though?
Well, the school wanted me to step down, so I offered I'd train my replacement before I do. They thought it was a great idea. Anyway, stop asking stupid questions. It shouldn't take more than 5 minutes to mop a floor. Ah! Ah, here it is. Ah, you gotta be careful with that. You don't want an old man to slip, do ya?
Did you see that? There was a ghost, I swear.
Ghost? There's no such thing. You probably just saw a eroded skitter pass or something.
What?
Just forget it, let's get going. We need to go to the auditorium. This is the auditorium. In all its glory, the equipment in here is very expensive, so be careful.
Wow, this is one big auditorium. And the curtains, wait, where are you going?
I have to go reset the lights for the next production. Now these darn kids don't know how to pick up, so go behind the curtain and do a quick sweep.
I don't have a broom.
Sir?
Jennifer.
I must be really spooking myself out. I need to get a grip, man. I need this job. Nope, not doing this. I'll deal with it later. This job's too important.
Did you get all that sweeping done yet?
Yeah, obviously.
Great, because I may have one more job for you.
I'm telling you, I've been seeing these ghosts all night. How have you not seen one in all the time you've worked here?
I swear, boy, if you can't get your imagination under control, you will not be able to handle this job on your own. Maybe I should cut you off now.
No, sir, please. I promise it won't happen again. I can handle it. Just get me to the end of the night.
Fine. You can stay till now. Help me clean this last flash room, and then we can turn in for the night.
Boo! I told you. Do you believe me now?
No time for that. Run! You. Tell Tracy to watch it on that bucket. I'm trying to keep my job here. Can't have him finding out it's me.
Yeah.
I've got two trainees coming in next week. Same time Tuesday?
Yep. I'm gonna need double. Job,
you guys. That was written by Will and Audrey, and then as you saw, Harris was the main actor, right? Yeah. And then Nick did the camera angles, so really nicely done. Round of applause for these guys. Okay. Up next, we have our TV news. This is our last thing for the night, and it's called Broke News.
You're watching Broke News, Max Chuckelson and Larry Funnyfeld. Weather with I'm a Little Cold. Sports with Ben Schwarmer. This is Broke News.
You're watching Broke News. You're Max Chuckelson
and you're Larry Funnyfellow,
and we are broke.
We're bringing the news live from the streets because that's where we live and that's who we care about.
In today's broadcast, the U.S. national debt now surpasses $34 trillion for the first time in history.
We will look at sports scores live from the bench, cooking meals from leftover or thrown out food, and look at the upcoming weather and how to survive these winter weather days. Looks like dinner's on me tonight, Larry. Hello?
Hi there. Hello?
Thank you for joining us.
I mean, I was just walking by.
Well, we've decided to tell everyone the news stories that we find out about and will now pass along to other people on the streets, where action happens.
Well, that's not really a new thing. Everyone tells each other stuff that happened. This morning, I stubbed my toe and it hurt so much that it farted.
What?
See, I just told you something that happened. That's already a thing.
No, see, we talk in this special voice.
I accidentally touched a hot burner this morning while making an omelet, and it hurt so much that I farted.
You want to see a doctor for that, because that's not a normal reaction to pain.
This morning I had a bowel movement so painful that I farted.
That one's probably normal, but you're making a mockery of this whole new thing that we're starting.
I'm basically doing the same thing, so you're not special at all.
No, we're special because we're going to speak about things that we find out, and we're also wearing suits.
Well, half a suit, but as far as you can see, we are wearing suits.
You are wearing suits. That's a good point. Okay, keep telling me about this new thing.
In other news stories that we found out about and will now be passing along to other people.
Way too long.
A cat was briefly stuck in a tree earlier this morning, but has since then been removed from the tree.
Okay, so maybe start by saying stuff that'll actually affect me and should be interesting and helpful.
We actually have another person here with us who will be speaking about the weather. I'm a little cold.
Thank you, Max.
Oh, very polite.
I'm a little cold. As I go through this forecast, keep in mind that while I don't get a massive paycheck, my commitment to accurately predicting the weather stands strong. As you can see on my cardboard forecast, temperatures this week will be below 20 degrees with wind chills in the negatives. It's very gloomy, kind of like our budget here. It will be tough surviving the winter, but don't ask me for advice because I've been living in the dumpster for the past 2 days. That's all for this week. I'm a little cold, signing off.
Wow, and you're sure about that prediction?
Yeah.
Cool, then I guess I'll check in daily.
Thank you, Ima.
See, that actually affected me. So that was actually interesting. The other stuff, not so much. I'm gonna go.
Wait. You're in danger.
What?
We are all in danger.
What do you mean?
A new study has shown that all the foods we eat has chemicals in it that cause cancer.
Oh my gosh.
Did you like that?
Well, I didn't like it, but you certainly have my attention now.
Okay. A crime. A violent crime happens constantly. We should all be afraid.
Well, I am.
Keep on listening to us more frequently to hear more on that.
I will.
Larry, maybe if we got into an argument, it'll be engaging.
No, Max. I think you're wrong on that one.
No, you're wrong, Larry.
No, you're wrong, Max.
Now this is entertaining. I can watch this all day.
Really?
See, now we really have this dummy's attention.
Hey, that hurt my feelings.
Okay, you really need to see a doctor about that.
But first, our top story. National debt continues to rise under President Biden. The national debt has grown to over $34 trillion for the first time in U.S. history, with over $6.24 trillion being added in 3 years since Biden took office in 2021.
President Trump added $6.7 trillion to the debt during his term, which included COVID relief in his last year.
President Barack Obama added a presidential record of $7.7 trillion to the debt over his 8 years in office. With presidential frontrunners in the 2024 election being Biden and Trump, there's very little doubt that without serious changes in spending direction, either candidate will become the new presidential debt leader by adding more to the national debt.
There is another debt ceiling vote later this month. You can't spend money that you don't have. How do you think we got broke?
With more insight, we send it over to a former stockbroker, now broke, Ned.
Oh, things are bad. About to get sad. Don't be glad. We should be mad. We're going down. We're all gonna drown. We'll all be poor. But wait, here's some more. We're owing debts. As you can bet, it will get worse. Yes, we're all cursed. We're all broke. And it's such a joke, cause there's no hope. No one can cope, we're all are doomed. Nothing's improved, don't even try. Just give up and cry.
Oh, I'm awake, I'm awake. Oh, camera. I'm Ben Schwarmer. The Ben Schwarmer. Sports. See what we got. The Cardinals beat the Dallas Cowboys 28-16. Colts beat the Baltimore Ravens in overtime 22-19. The Texans beat the Jacksonville Jaguars 37-17. And Fairleigh Dickinson beat Purdue 63-58. Why'd it have to be this week that the underdogs won? Bench Warmer, broke news.
With times like these, and very little to live off of, we are reduced to surviving only using leftovers and dumpster diving.
To help you in your time of need, we send it over to broke news chef, Betty Robber.
We can't afford to be called Food Network or have a host named Betty Crocker. Yikes, just think about that kind of money. Baking in general is just kind of expensive. Take Easy Bake Oven for an example. You can buy one on eBay for $20. $20? You've got to be kidding me. Why on earth would you want one of those? Did you know that Hasbro had to recall over 1 million Easy Bake Ovens? These ovens have resulted in the burning of children on a multitude of different scales. Now that is something you do not want to have on your record. Coming from someone who has not a clean record, I think that is a far better alternative. During my time in prison, I created the perfect recipe. Prison brownies. Just 3 ingredients, Oreos, and it's okay if they're stale. Milk, if it's sour, the better the flavor. And peanut butter, the weirder the name brand, the better it will be. Just combine these 3 ingredients and you will knock the Easy Bake Oven out of the park. No bake or burns required. Betty Robert, broke news.
The best part of waking up is Folgers in your cup.
The best part of waking up is quarters in our cups.
Police! Over here! You're watching Broke News!
Thanks again for coming out tonight. That's it. So hope you enjoyed the show.